turning to the federal government's controversial plan to drug test welfare recipients. It's an issue which divided our panel last Friday. Have a look.
How can you help somebody if you don't know they're on drugs? You have
That's
to know.
Why it's a
you have to
one.
Be able to find them
to
first.
Be fair, isn't this it's a three-strike system, isn't it? You don't. It's not like you automatically do not
no,
get
but
it.
No, but you get then your welfare gets and cut to a point, so you only get
only
vouchers,
after,
you only get
but
whatever.
Only after.
No, they start to cut it from the first time, and then they look at it and you get referred and
but
so
hang on.
On.
They don't actually give them money; they give them food stamps
and vouchers and so on.
Isn't there a risk though that then they then turn to crime or more crime if we take?
Well, I was about to say, we know that often drug dependency is a major cause of homelessness, so would people then just say, well, I'm scared to go to Centrelink now, so I can't quit the smack or the ice or whatever it is, and so I'm going to end up on the street.
For more on this, we're joined by Dr. Alex Wodak, the president of the Australian Drug Law Reform Foundation and a real forward thinker on drug reform. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
What are your initial thoughts on drug testing welfare recipients?
It couldn't be more wrong. This is not the way to treat people. This is going the wrong way. We've tried this for 50 years. We've tried punishing people who use drugs that the majority of people don't like, and it's just got the situation worse and worse. It's been an expensive way to make a bad problem worse.
When people argue that you are enabling drug users by giving them state money, what do you say to those people?
Well, why do we treat the illegal drugs differently from the legal drugs? Why not inflict the same punishment on people who use legal drugs, alcohol and tobacco, which after all kill many more people than the illegal drugs? The drugs that are now illegal became illegal through an accident of history. And so now, today, we're punishing people still after 50 years when we've just been digging ourselves into a deeper and deeper hole.
I suppose the government is also moving to restrict access to cigarettes and alcohol and that sort of things with other measures. But leaving that aside, the government thinks that if drug addicts know they'll be facing a test, that they will then go to get help for their problem. And the other angle which Denise raised is that it'll also help police identify drug users, which will help them get help. That'll sort of flush the problem out, pull the rug back. Is that not a good argument?
Joe, that's been the thinking for 50 years in official circles. But in fact, there are two scientific definitions of what drug addiction means, an international and an American one. And for both of them, an essential criterion is continuing to use those drugs, alcohol, tobacco and illegal drugs, despite severe adverse consequences. Mm. So we know that if someone who uses illegal drugs or alcohol, say, loses their children, loses their health, loses their partner, loses their freedom, loses their property, loses everything, they still keep on using drugs. And that's how we define this issue. So here we are making the same idiotic mistake yet again.
One of the issues that I think is problematic, when you look at it from the user's point of view, everything you're saying makes absolute perfect sense. But when you look at it from a governmental point of view or from someone else's point of view, they say, well, if this person wants to go and destroy their lives, that's fine. Why should we be paying for it? Why should the government be giving them money, which they could be giving to more worthy recipients, and why should my taxes be paying for it? Is it a two-sided perspective?
No, it's not a two-sided perspective. As a taxpayer, I also object to this. I pay taxes like everybody else. And my taxes are better spent investing in people, pulling them up rather than pushing them down. Mm. If my taxes are spent pushing people who are already vulnerable, pushing them down even further, they commit more crime, they commit more suicide. And I don't want that.
And it ends up costing more as well.
It costs us more as well.
Now, I very much applaud your stance. Are there some examples overseas that have worked with the sorts of ideas that you have?
All over the place. The countries, one after the other, are giving up this idea of trying to punish people into submission, drug users into submission, and recognising that everyone's better off, drug users, their family and the community, by helping these people more. Mm. So the Netherlands started that in the 70s, then Switzerland in the 90s, Portugal in 2001, and now we've got a raft of countries that are starting to move towards a much more reasonable and evidence-based and compassionate approach, which also protects their human rights. They're our brothers and sisters and sons and daughters. They're us.
Why do you think there is such opposition here, though, to change?
Well, the reason is that, frankly, is that bad policy has been good politics for a long time. And here we have a government that is, let's face it, trailing badly in the polls. I think yesterday was the 18th news poll in a row that they lost. Only supposed to allow to lose 30, and they're getting close to that, and they're panicking. So they're scraping the bottom of the barrel and throwing mud at people who really should be pulled up, not pushed down.
Just to play that really sort of real politic angle, Malcolm Turnbull, obviously, in his last budget, did a lot of really good things. He brought in a proposed level to pay for the National Disability Insurance Scheme, better funding for schools, a needs-based funding for schools. On the politics of that, if he needs to show the right, which is what he did, I suppose, we're going to, you know, be really tough on welfare, we're going to be tough on drug use, and that is the price that he has to pay for getting these wonderful nation-building things up that actually really help vulnerable people. Is that not fair enough in the real world?
It's understandable, but it's not fair enough. I want an Australia which is a fairer, more compassionate, more accepting country, and which works better for everybody. I don't want to see us fracture into different divisions. Now, I agree with you that I think the last budget that the federal government brought in did a lot of things I like, my family and friends like, but there are a lot of Liberals who were very critical of it. Here he is throwing red meat to some of his followers, hoping they'll unite again. Again, it comes back to what kind of country we want. Do we want a fairer country or do we want a more divided country? I want a fairer, more united country.
Well, further details on Dr. Wodak's campaign can be found at getup.org.au/drug test. Dr. Alex Wodak, always nice having you here. Thank you.